non-conferencey part of this conference session that I'm going to need a lot of your help with. In just a minute, I'm going to ask you to take your chair and move it toward the center so that we can all be facing this table here in the middle. I'm going to explain what we're all here for, this long table discussion on feminism and intersectionality. This long table idea was conceived of by an activist named Lois Weaver. She is an activist, artist, performer, and professor. And it really came from this experience that she had of going to conferences and sitting in the audience at panels and feeling like she had something really important to say, but that the format didn't allow for it, and it was a disempowered feeling. So she created this public forum to address that issue and to give people a voice in these panel discussions. So what's going to happen is we have this central table here in the middle, and this is going to be our panel space. We're going to have a dinner party discussion about feminism and intersectionality, and you all are the panelists, should you be so kind to participate. So there's some etiquette stuff we need to go over if you guys are going to be at my dinner party or our dinner party, as there always is. I'm going to go ahead and read the etiquette suggestions just to explain. So this is a performance of a dinner party conversation. Anyone seated at the table is a guest performer. Anything is on the menu. Talk is the only course. It is a democracy. To participate, simply take an empty seat at the table. If the table is full, you can request a seat. If you leave the table, you can come back again and again. Feel free to write comments or questions on the tablecloth. There can be silence. There can be awkwardness. There may be laughter. There is an end, but no conclusion. And that's an important part. We're going to end at 3 o'clock, no matter what, no matter where we are in the conversation. Does anyone have any burning questions? We get it? Okay, this is going to be the hard part, but I know that we can do it. If you could take your chair, it should already be unhooked, and just make it so that you're facing the center of the room, and so that you have a little bit of room to get out and get to the table if you would like to.
While we're sitting at the table together, what's your name?
I'm Lauren. What's your name?
I'm Amy.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Lindsay. Nice to meet you both.
Where are you from, Lindsay?
I'm from Texas.
And what do you do?
I'm an artist, and I'm a student. Artist. Double time. I go to Texas State. What do you do?
I'm a high school pottery teacher in Omaha, Nebraska.
What do you do?
I'm a third-year grad student at East Tennessee State University. Johnson City, Tennessee, Appalachian Mountains, buddy. That's where I'm at.
I love Appalachian Mountains.
So, it's a dinner party, right? So, the first thing that I think of as far as dinner party is like an etiquette. The one thing that comes into my head is with that is, has anyone seen A League of Their Own? Do you remember when they're being taught how to sit and how not to take up space? Cross your ankles. Yeah, like eyebrows, there should be two. Those are sort of the things that I think about when I think about like a dinner party. But that's from a perspective of a Southern woman growing up. So I'm just starting jumping in there with some feminist stuff. Anybody else want to jump in with that?
Going from the movie, I think of the phrase, there's no crying in baseball. And being a high school teacher, I'm very passionate about everything, as my students inform me. But it's very interesting that they have so many ideas of what I should be doing, being the teacher and being a female. Like, I have to get males involved if I feel like I'm not treated appropriately, like, they won't listen to the female in the class, but they need to have a male perspective to teach them that it's not okay to say certain things.
Agree. I teach some pottery classes, and I have similar experiences with gender in the classroom. What do you guys think about Jerry Saltz? Well, I liked his keynote yesterday. And we talked to, we're a group of certain people, we have a club or whatever, there's like five of us, and we talked to our professor afterwards, and she was like, he had a lot of sound bites, he had a lot of like short sentences that were supposed to mean something, you know, instead of like a real, this is what, I thought it was gonna be more about, you know, the Trump and the state of our country, and I thought it was gonna be a dramatically different than it was.
That panel discussion in particular, I watched you say, like, ask a question and the back and forth between, and so, honestly, what do you think about Jerry Saltz is my question.
I think he brings out the worst in us. So yeah, in terms of a feminist perspective, Jerry Saltz at NCECA, which has been a pretty intense conference for me.
I honestly had no idea who he was until he came here. And and that's, I probably shouldn't admit that because it's probably not a good thing, but it was interesting to, because he did seem very like, just do it, just get over it, you know? Which to an extent was okay, but looking at his Instagram, because then I looked him up and stuff like that, it was very different. I think, so on intersectionality though, like, do you feel that, is it the fact that it's like Jerry Saltz and he's like doing something, or do you feel like it's like, because it's like this white guy talking to us? Is that what your problem was?
I obviously told you that, yeah. what do I think? Well, I think he sort of betrays some super sexist, misogynist, just frameworks and ways of being that I think we should be running really fast from. But he's, so for me, that's what he symbolizes. So yes, he's a white man, and yeah, it's easier for them to embody that, just by
being a white man. Sorry, white men that are in the room.
They're fine.
Yeah,
there are many seats on the table. Also.
Yeah, come on, let's get a man. We need it. Yeah, just so y'all know, I'm a woman studies minor, so I'm like, I'm still learning about
that. Yeah, I have one of those too.
Yeah. And it's, I just recently did a feminist theory class, and it's been, I had no idea, there were so many different factions and different, like, we just got done taking a test on intersectionality, so I felt pretty. So what is y'all?
Hi, I'm Kate. I graduated with an undergrad, and now I just kind of live and can't wait to get back to school. But going to the movie that, or the film that we just got to preview, which was a great start to see something that I've never experienced, and women working really hard to do something I'm passionate about. And to me, the most important part of that is when they talked about how before they couldn't leave, they couldn't go anywhere, and then the woman said, where there were rocks, we had cleared them, so they could get out and they could learn and they could do what was important to them. And as someone, I moved to a really small town, and to me, watching these women go out and do everything they want to do and clearing the pathway for their daughters and nieces, that was the most important part of what we just saw, and it's really inspirational for all of us to think about these women who have no vehicle to get where they need to go, they carry everything on their backs, like, we can all do the same thing with 100 times more analyze.
I actually want to go off of that idea of like carrying a burden. I was at a talk earlier, and there was a white man who kind of was like, probably gonna say things wrong, and like, I really want you guys to educate me. And it was like a gendered play. the gendered clay talk.
Oh, yeah.
And the idea of like whose responsibility is it to like educate the white man? And I think like as a white cis woman, like it's 100% my responsibility, like to educate the white man, and like I think sharing that burden of the responsibility is something that like as women, and especially as like I come from a place of extreme privilege, being a white woman, especially in a middle class family, of taking on that burden. I think that that's something that's not talked about enough and not taken on enough by people in our community.
So I wanted to get back to talking about like intersectionality, especially with clay and this kind of institution, because I noticed like even the opening keynote speaker, he acknowledged that the art world is very white. I noticed within a workshop yesterday that people are acknowledging that it's white. That's good, that's the first step, but I haven't really seen any like tangible efforts to change anything. And so when I think about it, you know, to make something more intersectional, first you need to make things accessible. So places like this are really expensive for people. Some people might not have transportation. So I'm looking around and I hear people talking about intersectionality, but the spaces don't look very intersectional. So it's just things I've been thinking about.
To go off that, I missed the keynote speaker on Wednesday because I felt guilty taking 3 days off at work and leaving my students with the substitute. But I've been coming to these conferences numerous times, and I had to convince my school to let me come because I'm an inner city school, 85% Latino, and a mixture of everything else under the sun. So, but this is the first time, so I had to print out every lecture that was there and had to highlight things that would actually be fitting for my students. And I would say, like, this is the first time I've actually gone to lectures and stayed longer than 5 minutes because I have something to bring back to my students, which is nice to keep them, trying to keep them, keep on moving, keep on going forward. Like, it's not just like the little teacher sitting in the classroom just motivating, but like world experiences get there and give them the power.
I think that's it. It's really important to note that people like Jerry are part of an institution that's been around for a very long time. And the only thing that we can do to kind of change that is to stand up and to speak. And if when you can't speak, you make great work that speaks for itself. And you continue to make that strong work, and you ignore voices like the critics that are saying, you know, well, you know, don't do that because that's not how ceramics is made. Say, no, this is how I make ceramics, and I don't care what you think. And it's important as women to do that especially, and as women of all races, that we need to speak, because a lot of these, you know, white colonial ideals have been pushed down on us, and we really need to kind of, you know, be, you know, when we can't speak, because a lot of us aren't extroverts or able to speak, we make good work, and we make our work heard. And it's just really important to show that and not be afraid of that, and not listen to, you know, the mostly male critics and the mostly, you know, male teachers. And, you know, you just do what you need to do to speak for who you are.
Yes. I just feel like it's really easy to... We have also normalized our relationship to, or especially as a white man, I enter into watching Jerry Saltz talk, and I fall into the comedy, and I enjoy the performance, and I respect the the crassness of it. And it's so important to have a discussion like this where people are saying, yeah, but that is all part of this sort of patriarchal system that enables this bullshit that is so present. And so it's just critical that these discussions happen. happen, and I just wanted to say yes to you for that. So.
I think there's like one last thing I want to say on the at the dinner table to the dinner guests and everyone else listening is, I noticed, I think this probably comes from having like a diversity within spaces, but at this conference I've noticed that a lot of times people pull inspiration, and it's not entirely wrong to do this, but people pulling inspiration from the hardships and struggles that other people have. And when in talking about empowering people, people are always compelling others to do work that is political, that represents what they've gone through. And I honestly, I feel like it's revolutionary and radical to have art that depicts leisure and oppressed identities, as opposed to always just, oh, look at that struggle, they're so hard. Like, no, I feel like actually leisure artwork and oppressed identities is very important. And I think sometimes people can get caught up in the story of how other people were strong and draw out of that and actually make them one dimensional. That's great.
Is that right? Yeah,
V-A-N-L-Y-N. I go to every state college.
Oh. I love it all of you too. I just wanted to say your name. Yeah. I just wanted to say, kind of going off of what Van Lin said, and I'm really glad you came up here because it's true. These aren't very intersectional spaces yet. In the 15 years I've been coming to this conference, I've seen some baby steps, which is good. But what I would really like to see is other white folks recognizing the need for us to do some work on our own and really making like time to do that and not relying on the few people of color in our community to educate us. So if anyone wants to talk about that, and I'm Nicole and trying to work on that. So
one second up here.
Well, I just wanted to mention how beautiful this setting is at NCECA. Because it's so easy for us to talk about how amazing the work is or how amazing the lectures are. But really what change and empowerment comes from is this vulnerability, and the vulnerability of this dinner table that we're all sharing together and talking about serious issues and the strength that comes from that. And you sharing your ideas is just that, and that this is empowering in itself. So that's it.
Hi, I'm Ellie. I'm a woman. And I'm queer, but I'm white. And I've been thinking about intersectionality a lot. And what I want to say about it, just a quick thing, is the importance of listening. I'm also a teacher during the summer at an art camp at my school. And through that job, I've learned a lot about listening to people of all different ages, of all different backgrounds, people of all different cultures and colors. And I think that what was said earlier about who educates the white man, you need to listen. And I've, I've had to learn how to listen throughout my life, and I'm still working on it. But I think that that is your job as a white person, to listen to others' experiences that you will never have because of the color of your skin. Thank you.
My name's Tina, and I think it's really interesting for us to have this kind of format. It's a wonderful and kind of strange feeling. But what I wanted to add to this conversation is that you know, as we think of all the different types of demographics that we might fit into and the places where we overlap each other, that sometimes it's really hard to make the leap as to what somebody else's experience is. And I think that's the biggest challenge for that listening piece. But it's the most important, because I can't teach unless someone's willing to be receptive. So I think that's something for us to keep in mind. And I have early onset Parkinson's, which basically means suddenly I have like a bag full of certain kinds of challenges. and I've stepped into another section of the world of different ability. On one hand, I can still do all sorts of things that I used to be able to do, but I can't hip hop dance so well anymore. But that's working. But the kind of quick transition of that is a really interesting stepping through a door from one privileged group of able-bodiedness, and for me, particularly like kinesthetic able-bodiedness. I mean, I was a jock. And then stepping into this space where now sometimes my body is my enemy. And so I think there's something about understanding different ability that can be really helpful and a bridge to understanding all sorts of other less privileged status categories. And specifically that we can all become that. I mean, you're not going to go to sleep and wake up African American. You probably won't go to sleep and wake up queer. But you may have a very quick transition from able-bodied to differently abled. And that can help you make the reach of what are all these other people's life experiences like? What are the kinds of baggages that they take into trying to access different kinds of education, different kinds of professional opportunities, language barriers, and the application process, and all sorts of other things that might come from coming from like being a first-generation college student. And so if we can think about our own potential to become differently abled, it can be a really good doorway into understanding all sorts of other challenges that people face.
Hey, I'm Tashia Boba. I'm Native American. And I want to just kind of jump back to that topic earlier where people were talking about how you educate the white man. And I think that's kind of like, I don't know, I feel like I've been living with that my whole life. You know, people ask, like, my last name is runs through, okay? It's two words. It's translated from Nakota. It's Ohayage. And every time I introduce myself, it's like, I'm Tashia Bopa Onoa runs through. I'm Native American, and my tribe is Assiniboine, and they're from Montana. I have to give an entire history of my entire life because everyone will ask about it, you know? And they'll make a joke like, oh, why are you running through the walls? You know, like, oh, it's ridiculous. Okay, so I educate all the white men, and it's hard. And so a lot of times I feel like the easiest way to do that is just make friends with people, like, just reach out, and yeah, it's definitely not 100% anyone's responsibility to educate other people. That's hard. Don't take that upon yourself. And like, with my culture in particular, it's like we have these things that we do that seem normal to me, and since I got into clay, I tried to put those into my work, and one of my favorite things that I've started doing is like smudging down my pieces before firing them. And I think that is so, first of all, some of you guys might not even know what smudging is, right? Okay, it's like cleansing the air around it, your peat, like your body with sage. Sage cleanses everything. And then you burn the sweetgrass to bring in the good, like in the world. And it's just something that like you don't really get to talk about very often. And so when you make friends with people that are different, you learn about what they like and bring that in. I think that's like the best way to learn, just be friends with people.
I'm from Grand Forks, North Dakota. I've always been interested in art, and it's always been a passion of mine. It's something I've always done my whole life. But for most of my life, I was in banking and financing. That's so exciting. and then I went to on a mission trip, and I met wonderful women, just like in the video, and learned how hard the other half of the world has to live, or more than the other half. So I said, I'm going to give it all up. I'm going to be an artist. And people are like, you're crazy. And then they kept, so I went back to school in my 30s. And the first question people ask, well, are you going to be a teacher? Because I'm a woman. And I'm like, yes. But I was like, I feel like I'm an artist first. And you would never ask this male. And then I came across, and I see a lot of young, beautiful minds in here. And we've been having this problem that I've been coming across at our school. And these men, they're constantly asking women these outrageous questions. And they're almost too incomprehensible just to say. And I feel like as an older woman, and I have a responsibility to tell these girls, because we're born with like, oh, just don't say anything. Just, you know, let it go. Don't let it bother you. We have to not only teach people about like white privilege and men about that, we have to teach this younger generation of women that it's okay to tell somebody to stop when they've crossed that line. And that you can still say it without being a bitch. I swear. But, you know, you can. It's okay. You're taking back that issue. And that's just my two cents of what I felt. So, older, wonderful women and men, please do that.
Okay, I'm Madeline. I'm from Boise, Idaho, and I'm a senior in high school. One of my favorite stories is a story rooted in empathy. It's pretty amazing. So one day there are these women going off to the village to get their water from the water supply, and they have to walk like 6 miles there and then 6 miles back. And they do this every single day. And then this nonprofit organization realized that they have to walk this far to get the water. And then, so they thought they were being the heroes, coming in and thinking that they were gonna fix their problem of walking 12 miles a day to get their water. And once they got this beautiful, beautiful well in their village, and it was so awesome for the white people to come in and to do this in their village, and then they came back a year later and the well was not used once. It wasn't used because that time was for them, like their girl bonding time. Like that time was the time to like be away from their husbands or be away from their wild children for a little bit and just decompress and talk with each other in the community. So I think it's one of my favorite stories because you can't like, I know my voice is really shaky, but you can't like start like to find a solution with for something if you don't know the actual problem. So yeah.
So my name's Olivia and I hate public speaking, but I'm trying to do things that kind of scare me sometimes to grow. This is my first time at NCECA, and like it's kind of overwhelming, there's lots of stuff going on, and I was going to these different lectures, and it kind of feels like I wish there was more like open discussions like this, where people could feel like they could give their 2 cents on how they were feeling and what they thought. And for me, like, I go to a school where we have lots of discussions about things, and when they said that this was a dinner table, I immediately thought of like GG Chicago's The Dinner Table and like all the women artists. But as far as like this whole idea about racism and feminism and intersectionality, it just like all comes back to respect and like being open. And if you're just open to talk to people that you never would have thought you would have connected with, and you're open to other people's viewpoints, I think you can learn a lot and grow. And it might make you uncomfortable, but not everything
is going to be really comfortable in your life, and those uncomfortable moments will like allow you to grow and learn more. So I think that's an important thing to think about. Wanted to add that.
All right.
Hi, my name is Christina. I'm from Wyoming. And I just wanted to, we're getting a lot of questions about like, what can I do? How can I help? And I'm sure people here have this kind of frustrated feeling. And what I've found for me and for my friends is that the biggest effect you can have is to the people around you. So if you get really overwhelmed by like these big political ideas and issues that need to be changed, the best way to start is just by educating yourself. Like I'm sure most people here, how many people here have a smartphone with you? Google something, read an article, like look up some bell hooks, look up some Sojourner Truth, look up some Jessica Valenti, you know? Like get out there and read and then start educating your friends around you. And if you see your friends doing stuff that you know is not cool, call them out on it and just tell them like, it's not cool and this is why. And I just think that there's a lot of frustration between people like us who all want to see change and want to make change and help each other. And I think that you can start with yourself and educating yourself, and that's where your main responsibility lies. And if we all start doing that, then we'll get to a better place quicker, I think.
Yeah, I have something to say, I guess, along the same lines of continuing that. So my name is Amanda Schneider. I'm currently working and living in Vermont. And so when I have, basically I've been thinking a lot about this conversation about intersectionality, and people are really, especially like white people, keep being just really curious about what they do. And what I find is really important is that that you really need to start expanding as a white person, especially your mental Rolodex of like, for example, in NCECA specifically, if you want to be knowing more, if we want to make NCECA and the field of ceramics more intersectional, and then we need to be like doing the work ourselves to know more artists of color. Know, like, we get really excited about the fandom of people and forget that we need to be expanding our own Rolodexes in order to make it more diverse. And that also in our field specifically, we need to be careful not to tokenize the like couple of people that are already starting to talk about this that are artists of color, because if you just keep reaching out to the same one to two people to speak for the entire community instead of doing the work, then it doesn't actually make things more intersectional yet.
Just final comments. We have 1 minute left.
You guys can talk for 1 more minute.
Okay, I'm sorry. So I'm currently a student. There's been kind of a strange climate at the school I'm at. My name's Megan. Kind of piggybacking off of that idea of like the Rolodex and shameless self-promotion, but I'm a contemporary feminist artist at the Cleveland Institute of Art. There's just been a really complex climate just with some recent crime that has been happening and continues to happen in the Cleveland area, especially on campus. We lack campus police, and so it's been kind of a very strange climate, and through that, and just the women at school, going off of what someone had said earlier, just being able to not be intimidated by men, especially on the campus, and just continue to seek out female allies, because they'll always be there, and it's just good to see women artists being represented. This is a really cool thing, so thank you early for the last minute.
I just have a question, and that is, how do we all, or I, or all of us deal with not just the education, but also the extreme defensiveness and unwillingness to be educated?
And Amina, you're the last one.
Right, I'm Namita, I live here in Portland. And I wanted to share just briefly that I've been able to have some time in Europe, and I was at the European Ceramic Context exhibition at Bornholm in Denmark in 2014. And I just want to share that Europe does not equal white. When you're at an exhibition like that that's international, you start to understand the difference between Northern Europe and Southern Europe, Eastern Europe and Western Europe. And I think it's really important to think about the range of kinds of traditions, that intersectionality isn't just about whether you're bringing in other traditions that gets shoved off into electives, into your curriculum, into your programming, into what you're thinking about, but to also think about dissecting what whiteness is and understanding that that's not just a monolithic thing too. I think that's something to consider as well.
That was a wonderful place to end. Can we give everyone a round of applause?
So that the next person can start on time and have an easy, wonderful presentation. That would be great. Please help. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Betsy.
Thank you so much. It's been the best panel I've been to so far at NCECA. You know, like, wow.